Now, my basic day job these days, as Nigel said, is I'm in the broadcast business. You know, we're back in the broadcast business. In the broadcast business, as Clear Leap talked about, there are a lot of stations out there that are still, you know, running a bunch of tape decks and stuff like that. That is all changing. So, Titan Broadcast is our broadcast group, and we own one station and we manage another 20 for bankrupt broadcast groups, you know, where the hedge funds have hired us to do the turnaround and workaround. That's actually pretty good business for us. The broadcast business is not the dumb broadcast business as it's perceived to be. You know, there are a massive amount of technology changes. Carlos talked about one of them, you know, the flip phone. I don't have a flip phone, but, you know, pretend I'm holding one up. You know, I've embraced the flip phone and have told all of our news stations, most of ours are in the news business, that we ought to be using the flip phone to capture news in the field, and then sending it back, you know, just via wireless card, you know, from your laptop in a Starbucks or any place else where you can just pick up a network or a universal wireless card. And that flip phone will give you, you know, damn good video and replace, you know, even if you went 2 years ago and bought new cameras, Panasonic 200s, the latest, greatest, you know, HD cameras, I mean, it's about, you know, 10 pounds of stuff you have to carry on your shoulder, and you know, it costs $8,000, and then you have to plug it into a satellite truck or a microwave truck, what we call a giraffe mast, those big tall poles, and that's another $100,000 worth of crap, you know, to get a live news story. You know, flip phone is all our news people need, and then you have, you know, the video journalist can go out there, and it's not so much how HD the business is now, it's how immediate, spontaneous it is, as Carlos was also saying. Now, I disagree with Carlos. I mean, I'll shill the flip for him, but I disagree with him on the need for, you know, the video conferencing. I mean, we do it all the time. I just use Skype. And, you know, I do, or I use Uvu if I want to do five, or, you know, five people in the same time. But, yeah, I do 25, 30, you know, video conferences a day, you know, talking to people, and it's every bit as good as well, not quite. You know, having somebody face-to-face where you can hold on to them is one bit better, but not enough to justify not doing that. But the big challenge we have in the broadcast business is this. This is the RF spectrum. And it is as messy as it looks there on the screen. That is how, you know, the 3 megahertz, you know, that's how all the signals are divided up. And if you look in there, the pink bands, if you can see the ones that are pink, that's mobile and wireless. And everything else is something else. The big blue ones you see in there are broadcasting. So guess what? We are in the zone, we are in the target zone. The government wants to get more broadband, more spectrum allocated to wireless, and I think they're right, even as a broadcaster. And if you go down about the third or the fourth row down is where the battleground is. The upper three rows, for the most part, you know, the wavelength is too long for mobile. But, you know, this part right here are two bands of frequency that the broadcasters reside on, and if I blow them up, you're going to see the left block are channels 21 through 36, and the right block are channels 37 through 51. Not labeled, but that's where they are. The government wants to get 500 megahertz back somewhere in there and reallocate public service spectrum and other things, and they want 120 megahertz back from the broadcasters. So we're going to have to figure out how to repack the channels and how to work together. And we're all for that. You know, we think there is no reason to have 5, 6, 7, 8 separate television stations in a market all doing the same thing. And I believe a television station right now is nothing but a big iPod. You know, we take all our product in digitally, we store it in a server, and we play out playlists. That's an iPod. You know, they don't need to be all these separate facilities. If we can mash them all together, And then use our spectrum together, we can free up spectrum. And the drill here is going to be for us as broadcasters to figure out how to sell our spectrum before the government takes it from us. So that's our big challenge. You know, in addition to trying to figure out how to run everything cheaper, how to use smaller, better equipment, how to make people run faster and jump higher, with less people, you know, most of our industries have, that's the broadcast side. And then trying to put good content on the air and deal with networks that are really hard to negotiate with. Now, I'll talk about a few of the other companies that we invest in. With Mike and Bonds, we have a office building we call the Clubhouse, right, about 8th and Marietta. We affectionately refer to the area as Ghetto Tech. They now call it West Midtown, but I don't think that's got enough panache. But we've got 20 people in there that use us as kind of an executive suite. 15 companies are resident in there, and then we all together invest with Bonds and McHugh and I as kind of the lead of this, you know, invest in deals, companies. We put our own capital up, and then we pass the hat around, what I call a bowling team, and we invest in companies. So it's a fund with no fund. You know, and everybody's big boys, you know, they invest in, take their own chances. We don't call it angel investing. That never worked for any of us. You know, so we're early fund investors. Vitru is one of those. And one of the things we like to do is back entrepreneurs or racehorses. Vitru was founded by a guy named Reggie Bradford, most of you may know. And we met Reggie when we all invested in WebMD. I was one of the first investors of WebMD. That was a very good one. Reggie was the head of marketing. He's done one other company since, and then he came to us with a business plan 2 years ago to do Vitru. What Vitru was 2 years ago, I can't honestly remember. It is not what it is now. We've migrated that company. What that company is now is a phenomenally successful social media management tool. And Carlos was talking about the absolute importance of Facebook and Twitter. I think there's a lot of insane uses for those things that is just drivel, but it is a very, very important marketing tool for corporations. And corporations need to be on Facebook, need to be on Twitter, they need to be employing those, and this business needs to be local. This is not a national or international business. This needs to be as local as you can get it. And what Vitru has come up with is a service company that's productizes services. Now, that's the nirvana we never figured out at IXL. Everything we did were one-offs. We never could productize our business. Never could make it that efficient. Vitru has done it. They have taken a campaign for Facebook and Twitter, a holistic marketing campaign, and all the products to integrate, have productized it, and have signed up some of the biggest companies, marketing companies, Fortune 500 companies to that, including Chick-fil-A, Wendy's, Pepsi, Miller, and they just signed up McDonald's, and they just signed up last week, you know, Ashton Kutcher and Ryan Seacrest's company. So you're getting, you know, individuals that employ these services as well as big companies. Reggie's not here today. He's up in New York signing another company. But Vitru is taking advantage of that exact trend that Carlos talked about and has a very scalable campaign for that. So watch for Vitru. Vitru is right here in Atlanta. Right now it's headquartered Midtown and down by CNN Center, and we hope to bring them into the area where we are as they relocate. Some of the customers I just mentioned for Vitru, very cool company and very profitable. A great way to be.